nature and who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us. And it never asked for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
Good afternoon or good evening, everyone. On behalf of Calgary Public Library, I would like to welcome you all to today's program in partnership with the Department of Classics and Religion at the University of Calgary. Today's program is Peter Craigie Memorial Lecture, an afternoon with Professor Francis X. Clooney. It is being recorded and will be later available online. During the presentation, please feel free to submit your questions through the chat and we will read them at the end. I would now like to introduce Dr. Marika Kassis, Associate Professor and Head, Department of Classics and Religion at the University of Calgary. Dr. Kassis specializes in the late Roman and Byzantine past of Central Anatolia, and her research sits at the intersection of the Greek and Roman studies and religion programs. Dr. Kassis did her PhD in Byzantine and Syriac studies at the University of Toronto in the Department of Near and Middle Eastern Civilizations. She is the director of the Byzantine excavations at Çadır Hoyuk, a multi-period site in Yozgat province, Turkey, which is funded by Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council. Dr. Kassis is currently writing a book on Byzantine archaeology for Arc Humanities Press and also works on the incorporation of gender theory into Byzantine archaeology, which considers how to ask new and more inclusive questions of archaeological material. Dr. Kassis.
Good morning good afternoon. Thank you all for being here today. I'm going to start with a brief introduction to the lecture series before I move on to our very exciting talk for today. So, inaugurated in 1988, this lecture series honors the memory of our colleague and friend, Dr. Peter Craigie, who died in 1985. Professor Craigie was a member of the Department of Religious Studies. He was Dean of the Faculty of Humanities and Vice President Academic of the University. Dr. Craigie was a prolific and highly esteemed scholar of religious traditions, particularly in the fields of biblical studies and Ugaritic studies. His training and work in Semitic studies generally and biblical studies specifically provided important crossover between the academy and lived traditions, and his legacy is commemorated in this lecture series. Each year, a distinguished lecturer is invited to address the university and Calgary area communities on topics from the discipline of religious studies. Our speakers come from a wide range of religious disciplines, and the focus of the lecture is precisely this connection with the lived religious traditions that was so much part of Dr. Craigie's work. The lecture series is sponsored by the Faculty of Arts, the Department of Classics and Religion, and the Faith and Spirituality Center at the University of Calgary. The department feels particularly privileged to host this lecture series. I would also like to offer my sincere thanks to the Calgary Public Library and the Faculty of Their Arts for the help in hosting of this lecture, and a special thanks to the Craigie Committee, which includes Dr. Betty Craigie, Dr. Carolyn Musick, Dr. Joy Palacios, and Paul Verhoff. And much thanks for all the support this year in organizing this lecture. I would also invite you to consider attending our departmental seminar tomorrow at 3:00, when Dr. Clooney will lecture on Toward a Comparative Theology, Faith Seeking Understanding Across Religious Borders. On Monday, he'll also be talking with the Faith and Spirituality Center on Interreligious Teaching. Details for both are available on the CLARE website. So the lecture, just one small piece of housekeeping, the lecture runs today from 1 to 2:30. So with no further delay, I'd like to introduce our distinguished and wonderful speaker, Dr. Francis Clooney. Francis Clooney is the Parkman Professor of Divinity and Professor of Comparative Theology at Harvard University. After earning his doctorate in South Asian languages and civilizations at the University of Chicago in 1984, he taught at Boston College for 21 years before coming to Harvard in 2005. His primary areas of Indological scholarship are theological commentarial writings in the Sanskrit and Tamil traditions of Hindu India. He is also a leading figure globally in the developing field of comparative theology, a discipline distinguished by attentiveness to the dynamics of the theological learning deepened through the study of traditions other than one's own. His most recent book is Western Jesuits in India, Tracing Their Paths, Reassessing Their Goals, Jesuit Studies Series 28, Brill 2020. Of particular interest to the followers of the Peter Craigie Lecture Series will be his work on interreligious learning in the modern world, exemplified by several of his recent works, the co-edited How to Do Comparative Theology, Fordham University Press 2017, The Future of Hindu-Christian Studies, A Theological Inquiry, Routledge 2017, and Learning Interreligiously in the Text in the World, Fortress 2018. And most notably, Reading the Hindu and Christian Classics, Why and How It Matters, University of Virginia Press 2019. It is an immense honor to have Dr. Clooney with us for this series of lectures, and it is with great pleasure that I introduce his talk, The Autobiographical Turn on the Origin and Future of My Work in Hindu-Christian Studies. Dr. Clooney, thank you for being with us.
Thank you very much. So I begin by expressing my gratitude to Marika Cases for that very nice, welcoming, warm introduction, to Zarika, Vazdenak for her opening words, and also for the welcome from the public library, which was also very kind. I'm very sad on both counts for not actually being with you, but being with you by Zoom, but I'm glad for this opportunity to speak today. I'm also mindful in terms of the introduction of the legacy and the history of Dr. Peter Craigie and his importance in the Calgary community. His life tragically cut short when he was only a young man still. And I'm mindful of that because as I get older, I'm also mindful of how we work at different times in our careers and what would have been for Dr. Craigie had he been able to continue the fullness of his life. I was told that Dr. Betty Craigie is with us today, and I would love to meet her sometime, but very glad that this living connection to Dr. Peter Craigie's memory is possible. So I will go through a number of points really about a mixing of my own life and the issues arising from the kind of study that I do over the generations since I began my work some 50 years ago in my first encounter with going to India, and try to weave a way of thinking about how at different points in our lives, we speak to the needs of our time, we speak to the opportunities before us, and we need to keep thinking about how the world is changing around us as we do our work. I will try to speak only 45, 50 minutes or so. I usually say that and then go a bit longer, but nonetheless, I'll try to keep myself short and then have plenty of time for conversation and questions, which for me are always the most interesting part. So I begin in several ways by first of all pointing out that as I've turned 70, so I'm no longer very young, I have a lot of history behind me in several ways. The first is that I'm a Catholic priest. I'm a member of the Society of Jesus and have been a Jesuit now for 53 years, going on 54 years. And I've been a Catholic priest for over 40 years. And had all of the training and the benefits and the formation, or some say the deformation of that kind of training for much of my life. The 10 years that it takes to become a Jesuit, the study of philosophy, the study of theology, the study of the classics, Greek and Latin when I was in the course, all of these things have been very much a part of my life. And for me as a young man, very formative in terms of my identity, living largely in community setups, all these years, teaching for many years at the Jesuit University, Boston College. I'm a regular practitioner in the sense that I've been helping out in a parish almost all of the time in the past 40 years, the same parish now in the Boston area for over 20 years. So these things are part of my life simply as an individual to get started. And what I would like to return to at the end of this talk is the very idea of how one is both a scholar and a practitioner at the same time. How do you weave together what you study and who you are as a person? And again, how does that change as one's life goes on? The other starting point for me was less predictable, because having grown up in New York City, Irish Catholic, gone to Jesuit school, entered the seminary after high school, there was zero indication, zero hint that at any point in my life, I would go to India or be interested in Hinduism or be concerned about interreligious dialogue, which has very much defined my life. And it sort of happened almost by chance when we came to the part of Jesuit formation that involved teaching. I was invited to teach in one of the Jesuit schools in New York City, Regis High School that I had gone to, Xavier High School, et cetera, and simply stay in New York. Or they told me you could go somewhere else. And so I took that seriously and said, well, I'd like to go to India. And it turned out that going to India, which fascinated me because of the ancient culture, but also because of the challenges, social challenges of a vast population with the gap between rich and poor, there'd be so many things that I would be open to by going to that wonderful part of the world. I found that I couldn't go there, so because of visa issues in the early 70s, but went instead to Kathmandu and taught for several years at St. Xavier's School in Kathmandu. And that was, for me as a young man, I was only 22 when I got there, a very formative experience of suddenly finding myself no longer within the city limits of New York, but suddenly 10,000 miles away on the other side of the world, teaching in a school that was indeed in the missionary tradition of the Jesuits, and I'll say a word about that later, but it had been set up at the deliberate invitation of the King of Nepal, who in 1950, some 20 some years before I got there, had invited the Jesuits to come in from Patna in India to come up to Nepal and set up a school because he wanted good education in the country. And he said, who better than the Jesuits to do this? So I was teaching in a school where all the boys were Hindu and Buddhist. Most of the staff were Hindu and Buddhist. The fathers, the Jesuits, were mostly from the West, but nonetheless, the school was very much a Hindu-Buddhist environment. And for me, it was an eye-opening experience before I studied, before I learned any of the text and so on, to be there up front in the classroom, talking to students outside of class, going around the city with students, and sort of experiencing Hindu and Buddhist life as a starting point for who I was and who I was to be. I was particularly fascinated from the start by the ritual life of the Hindu and Buddhist communities of Kathmandu. I think we all know something about the great stupas in Bodhnath and Swayambhunath, the indigenous Nepali Buddhist traditions, but also the Tibetan Buddhist traditions that had come down fleeing Tibet in the 50s, but also the very old Hindu temples in the center of Kathmandu, in the town of Patan, and then outside the valley. I remember vividly visiting the great Dakshin Kali temple, the goddess temple outside the valley. And for me, these things were both, on the one hand, exotic and different from anything I had grown up with in New York. And yet in some ways, because growing up in the Catholic Church, there was so much a sense of the ritual, the liturgy, the music, the flowers, the incense, and so on. There was a certain kind of recognizability that I found that even though I was somewhere very far away, going to these holy places of Hinduism and Buddhism were not strange to me, were not foreign for me. So that was really important for me. The other thing was that I began to read Hindu texts for the first time. I began to read texts like the Bhagavad Gita, which is a text that I've used so many times in class over the years. I learned some of the basic stories of the Ramayana, the story of Rama and Sita, the Mahabharata, the great epic, began reading passages from the lives of the Buddha and so on. But I think the first text that actually caught my attention and riveted me was a text that I just picked the book off the shelf in the library and opened it, a little book called Gitanjali by Rabindranath Tagore. Turned out to be the book that won for him the Nobel Prize. He was the first non-European to win the Nobel Prize in literature. And it was this wonderful little book of poetry for which William Butler Yeats wrote the introduction. And I'll just read you part of one of the songs that clicked for me in my early months in Kathmandu. And most of the songs in Gitanjali are prayers. And the opening, the one that I have, number 63, goes this way. Thou hast made me known to friends whom I knew not. Thou hast given me seats in homes not my own. Thou hast brought the distant near and made a sister and a brother of the stranger. I am uneasy at heart when I have to leave my accustomed shelter. I forgot that there abides the old and the new, and that there also thou abidest. I could go on, but I'll leave it at that. But what struck me there was that there was kind of a recognition. This was not something entirely exotic. Now, Tagore could be a whole lecture, but nonetheless, the sense of the spiritual intuition, the intellectual recognition that somehow what Tagore out of Hindu tradition was talking about was somehow touching me as the guy from New York. And that there was a bond there that I found that opened for me the door and said, this country, these people, this culture, these books, these temples do not have to be foreign for me. I can find my way here and find a way of recognition. And I think really that starting point, given first my Jesuit education and formation in the Society of Jesus, but then being there in Kathmandu and having these possibilities opened, really formed the two strands of my life that ever since the 70s have been woven together. And much of what I will say in the next half hour is really about making those connections. How do you come from a certain background with a certain commitment that you stick with over the years? And how do you learn things new and fit them in without erasing the differences? And I think for me, it became very personal, but it also became very academic as well. So I continued over the years as a young Jesuit to visit India, visit Nepal. I spent those 2 years in Kathmandu in the mid 70s. I went back while I was writing my dissertation in Hindu studies at the University of Chicago. I spent another year plus down in Madras, then Chennai now, in South India, living in kind of an ashram setting and studying Sanskrit and Tamil texts and so on. I went back again in 92, 93 on sabbatical, again studying devotional texts in the South Indian context. And I probably had altogether nearing 20 trips back and forth of longer duration or shorter duration over the years. I've always looked forward to going to India and Nepal and South Asia. I think it's the one part of the world that I go that I feel it's a kind of homecoming when I go there. Actually, two places. One, Ireland, because my grandparents came from Ireland. I feel somewhat at home going to Ireland. And the other place is India, where I think it's just become part of who I am, that going there is not a strange experience, but a very personal experience. And needless to say, I'm grateful for many Hindu friends, both in India and in Nepal. I keep in touch occasionally with some of the boys I taught nearly 50 years ago, and many Hinds and Hindu friends and colleagues here in the United States. And so it's been a part of, for me, a way of life over the years. But being a professor type, a scholar type, I live a lot of my life in the books. You can see some of my books on the shelf next to me, and I have tons more. If you want a tour of my office, I can show you them all sometime. Is reading text, and reading text for me has not been a substitute for, or instead of having real life connections with India, Hinduism, Hindu practice, and so on like that, any more than reading St. Augustine or Thomas Aquinas or Luther or Calvin. These figures would be a substitute for Christian life. Now, the Hindu life and the Hindu friendships and the Hindu practice that I've been informed by over the decades has been endlessly enriched by study. And I think for me, that's very much part of really what I'm wanting to share with you today, is how what we study and what we live go together, and how you become, in a sense, what you study if you study it for a long time. So as I said already, I had those 10 years of Jesuit training, which were not geared for interreligious study, and were basically studying the Christian classics. But starting in Kathmandu, reading Tagore and reading the Bhagavad Gita and so on, I became very involved in learning from the Hindu traditions. When I was ordained a priest in 1978, I received permission to go on for doctoral studies. And so, as I alluded to earlier, I went to the University of Chicago, the Department of South Asian Languages and Civilizations, where I did a PhD in basically Sanskrit studies, although I started learning Tamil, the great language of South India, at the same time. and basically plunged in to reading texts. The University of Chicago, the South Asia department then and perhaps now, was very much dedicated to teaching you to read, and then you can do what you want with what you read. A great sense of kind of a classic tradition. And so I immersed myself in the reading of the text. I discovered wonderful traditions like the one that few people have heard of, the Purva Mimamsa, which is a system of kind of liturgical ritual reasoning that spells out in some 900 cases, every conceivable case of ritual Vedic reasoning, Vedic textual analysis, such that you really, in the nitty gritty of reading the words and studying the rituals, you begin to understand the Dharma. What exactly is the true meaning of the universe and of your place in it? And I found that fascinating and ended up writing my dissertation on it and studying to an extent the Vedanta, far more well known in the West, the non-dualist Vedanta of Shankara, the theistic Vedanta of Ramanuja, studying these systems that grew out of the same kind of analysis that one has with the Purva Mimamsa. So I learned these things, which are highly intellectual, in learning the Sanskrit, learning to read the text. Some 40 years later, I'm still learning to read Sanskrit. It's a difficult, challenging language. And the more you know, the more you realize you don't know. So it's an ongoing process. But while I was in Chicago, I also discovered the Tamil tradition. And here too is an unexpected bond for me, because I went to Chicago hoping simply to learn classical language, Sanskrit, as I had learned Latin and Greek earlier. And yet having to learn another language, I picked up Tamil. Picking up Tamil is rather a casual way of putting this very difficult language, but nonetheless struggled with it. I think the hope was that we would become, you know, experts in contemporary Tamil, which has never quite succeeded for me. But rather I became a connoisseur of medieval Tamil poetry, devotional poetry in the Tamil Middle Ages, which, like the song of Tagore that I read to you at the beginning, spoke to me, and I wanted to read this tradition. I wanted to immerse myself in it. Let me just read you one small verse from Namalvar, the greatest of the Tamil poets of the 9th century or so in South India. And it's addressed, it's a prayer. It's again addressed to Narayana Vishnu, the god of the Sri Vaishnava tradition. In the time when I did not know you, when I was caught up in my great confusion, you made this servant love your service. Once, as an innocent dwarf, you asked 3 steps of land, Mahabali. You tricked him into giving you everything. And now you've mingled with my life's breath. In return for that great good gift of your mingling with my breath, I gave you everything. So what now can I give you back? You are the breath of my breath. You are my father, my mother, who has consumed all 7 worlds. Whose is my breath? Who am I? I am only what you have given me, what you have made me to be. That's my limping English translation of beautiful Tamil poetry. When I was back in India in 1992-93, I tried to go to as many of the temples as possible and see the recitation of such hymns, the daily worship, the feasts, and so on like that. But the point again for me was that there was a kind of a recognition that this was not something foreign. It was something foreign, but it was also something I could connect with that became part of my way of being. And people have asked me over the years, when you read poetry like this, how can you read it so seriously and reverently when you're a Catholic and they're Hindus? You're a Christian and they're pagans. How can you do this? And he said, well, there may be large issues and big theological concerns about how these things are possible, but my concern is to begin with the recognition. You recognize something, you find your way into it, it touches you, and suddenly you realize I am the person I was before, but now I'm different as well. And the connection back and forth, as in the first line of the verse, in the time when I did not know you, when I was confused, you made me love your service. We often get involved in things that we don't really know or really understand, and they become part of our lives. So through the years, since that PhD at the University of Chicago, as Marika indicated in introducing me, finishing my PhD in 1984, getting a job at Boston College, a wonderful Catholic university, Jesuit university, which is was growing wildly and becoming very wonderfully international, interreligious in the years I was there, over 20 years. teaching there, studying there, going back to India when I could, learning, reading my Sanskrit, reading my Tamil. All of these things were kind of flowing together for me, and mindful of the fact that I had my Jesuit strand of identity and my study of Hinduism, living the Hindu tradition strand of identity, and they were coming together for me. And I've always tried over the years to keep them connected. So even this past awful year of pandemic, this year when everything seems to have gone wrong and so many have tragically died, teaching on Zoom, spending far too much time sitting in this very chair, looking at this same screen, teaching, as I'm sure many of you have had to do again and again, but also even giving, doing the Catholic Mass online, doing Zoom Masses, recording Masses so they can be played in the church on the weekend, and then kind of crazily undertaking to write homilies every weekend to be posted online. So I'm doing my Sanskrit work, my Tamil work, my teaching work, giving the Catholic Mass, writing homilies and so on like that, and all of this woven together, which I think becomes inextricable. Sometimes when people talk about interreligious learning, they want to know, well, which side of the line are you on? And you're on that side of the line, and that's where you belong. And then you visit the other side, and you sit at a table, and you have a dialogue, and you bow to each other, and then you go home. But I think realistically in our lives, so many things are going on that are not predictable in that fashion. And that's really what I think as I get older, I look back and begin to be mindful of. I could go on in great detail, and I'll do some of this tomorrow at the session that Marika mentioned, the comparative theology session about how I do my writing, how deliberately, consciously I cross back and forth between Hindu and Christian texts in my writing projects all the time. That's what I like to do. Books like Hindu God, Christian God, Divine Mother, Blessed Mother, His Hiding Place is Darkness, which is a meditation on the Song of Songs of the Bible and Tamil mystical poetry. Doing all this kind of thing and making a life of it. I'd be happy to talk, answer any questions about this, obviously. But trying to do all of this in a time in which everything is changing around us. I'm mindful of the fact that when I started teaching in 1984, Boston College, a relatively large university, 9,500 undergrads, had a certain still Catholic identity, but was becoming, as I said, international and interreligious at the same time. Looking back now, as I think I'm finishing my 37th year of teaching, how things have changed. I mean, I've certainly gotten older over the last 37 years, but also my classes have changed, the kinds of students I get, even at BC. It was a changing student body, students coming for different reasons out of different backgrounds. All of this was changing. And then certainly shifting from BC to Harvard was quite a change in terms of who comes to Harvard Divinity School, the interfaith context of the school, the changes coming, that my writing, my teaching, my Catholic practice are evolving over time. And I think for any of us, and I'm sure it's the same for you as for me, to be aware that as we live our life, if we're mindful of where we're coming from, we can see that there are continuities and commitments we make when we're young that we try to keep when we're old, but also that it's all changing, that the chemistry of it changes over time in the world in which we see around us. And two of the, I'd like to point out two of the larger contexts in which I'm mindful of how things have been changing. One has to do with India and Jesuits in India, and the second has to do with the amazingly fast changing life here in the United States. India first. So I've told you already, I go to India whenever I can and hope to go again soon once travel is possible again. But it's a particular stake for Jesuits to go to India because the order, the Society of Jesus, was founded by St. Ignatius Loyola in 1540. And within 2 years, his most famous comrade, Francis Xavier, who became St. Francis Xavier, went to India. So the first Jesuit to leave Europe, the first Jesuit to go to Asia was Francis Xavier, who went to India. He eventually went on to the Moluccas, the islands, he went on to Japan. He died still a young man in his 40s, trying to enter China. He wanted to meet the Emperor of China and explain to him how things really are regarding the faith. He never got there because he died on the way. But Jesuits have been in India for a very long time. And I think from the start, I mean, first of all, my name is Francis Xavier. That's a hint about the Jesuit strand of my identity even before I was a Jesuit. Francis Xavier in India, me in India, the connection over a nearly now 500-year history of Jesuit missionaries going there. I was always mindful of the fact that I'm doing my own thing in Kathmandu, in Chennai, and other parts of India, but it's part of a very long process that goes way back. And it's quite impressive that one of the collections that Marika mentioned, Western Jesuit Scholars in India, a collection of 15 articles and chapters that I've written over the years, was all connected with the idea of beginning to understand this great history of which I was a part. And there were Jesuit teachers. We have a fantastic set of school system, high schools and colleges all over India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, many, many educational institutions which are highly respected, in many parishes, mission stations, all kinds of ways in which Jesuits worked with the fisher folk along the coast, tribal peoples in the north of India, so many things that Jesuits have been involved with. But what struck out at me, struck me unsurprisingly from the start, is that the Jesuits were also, some of the Jesuits were scholars who wanted to understand what are we doing when we come from the West and come into this great culture of the East, not having the advantage of dictionaries and grammars and all kinds of background. You plunge into a Hindu culture and suddenly you're there and you have to learn the vernacular languages. You have to hope to learn some Sanskrit. You see the temples. You're disposed by your Catholic training to say, this is all idolatry. This is all terrible. And that, but then you begin to see some kind of holiness there as well. A 500-year effort to understand what it means for a Christian to meet a Hindu, or a Society of Jesus to meet the devotees of Krishna and Rama and Shiva and the goddesses and so on. Much of that history was extremely apologetic, even you might say polemical. We are here to honor your culture. We are here to help you people, but we also want to convince you that your religion is not rational. It's not tenable. And that if you really think about it, you will come over and still be Indian, still have your culture, still have your language, but do it as a Christian. And in many times, in ways that today we find embarrassing, they were, I think, misunderstanding and being needlessly hostile toward the cultures they were meeting. And there's a lot of unhappy rhetoric in the Jesuit tradition in India. But what struck me, despite all of that, and despite, you might say, their taking advantage of colonialism, being protected by the Portuguese, by the British and others, they were also trying to understand as deeply and enter into, not as traders, not as merchants, not as soldiers, not as governors, but as religious people, enter the culture religiously. And I said, well, I'm part of that too. And I think over the years, I found that helped for me to put myself in a long tradition. And in some ways it's been either successful or not successful, depending on how you count. The largest number of Jesuits in the world are now native indigenous South Asian Jesuits, over 4,000, far more than the US now. So many, many Jesuits in India, in South Asia. I mentioned the many schools, the wonderful work with the poor for liberation movements, Jesuits involved in just about everything you can think of in the media and so on in India. But now, after 500 years of Western Jesuit presence in India, I'm not talking about the churches of Kerala, the older churches, the churches that were there long before the Portuguese came, but the Western Roman Catholic community adds up to about 1.5% of the population. So not great numbers of converts given all the effort over 500 years. And one also begins to notice that much of this great missionary history had to do with, we come from the West, we appear in this culture, we have to find a way to become part of India's identity, India's culture, to fit in. But now that the 4,000 plus Indian Jesuits have taken over, they don't have that problem. They're not coming from the West. They are fitting in, they are Indian. It's a highly complex and somewhat there's a lot of strife in India today about religious identity and majority and minority and so on. But still, the Indian Jesuits have other concerns and other issues to think about. And it became aware to me, both I was both admiring this long tradition of which I was part, the Western Jesuits coming to India, and the incredible work about the gospel, religion, culture, being open, but keeping the faith. What's the boundary? What does it mean to convert? What does it mean to switch religions? All of these issues were living issues. And yet in some ways, the grand experiment of Western Jesuits in India and the Western churches in India has really come to an end. Yes, as I mentioned, there are very many long-term staunch Christians and Protestant and Catholic and the Syriac churches of Kerala and others who were there for a very long time. All of that's still the case. But nonetheless, the great movement from the West and the great kind of posing dialogue as these, the West meeting India, is basically over with. And I realized that if I was simply to imagine myself in the footsteps of Francis Xavier or Robert de Nobili, another famous missionary, or other famous Jesuits of the 18th, 19th, 20th century from the West, in a sense, I would be way out of date because the problems have shifted. And that no longer is the issue how to bring Roman Catholicism to India. In a sense, it's up to the Indian church and the Indian communities how to be Christian in the Indian context. And that's a different set of issues that have now come to the fore. And so I had to ask myself, well, what am I doing if I'm still writing and still studying text and so on, if some of the issues with which I started are no longer the operative issues anymore? The other side of it, aside from that problem about India and Jesuits, is the very nature of the changing world in which we live. Here in the United States, Canada, North America, the places where we are today. And I'll just run through a few obvious changes and we can talk about this later, but I was ordained a priest in 78. I entered the seminary in 68. And 5 years before that, the Roman Catholic Church had the great council called Vatican II. And so many changes began to take place then that we're only still digesting the changes in the church, what it means to be Catholic, what it means to be Catholic in the modern world, how to pray, how to have liturgy, who's called to ministry, the place of men in the church, the place of women in the church, issues about sexual morality, about rich and poor, the church and politics, all of these things. We're in a very dynamically changing situation that makes it very different from what it was in 1960 or 1970. And so I think one has to be thinking differently about what does it mean to be Roman Catholic, period. And there may be analogs in other churches, I'm sure. What does it mean to be a religious person is still an issue. And then different popes giving different messages. So the openness of John the 23rd, the effort of Paul the 6th to try to keep things on a steady balance in the years right after the council. John Paul the 2nd, who was a pope for so long, being very conservative on certain issues, but on other issues, being an interreligious pioneer. Going to the Western Wall in Jerusalem, going to a mosque, praying in a synagogue, having that wonderful 1986 meeting in Assisi, where he gathers leaders from different traditions to pray for peace in the same place at the same time. And incredibly kind of cementing the idea that the church is now to be interreligiously alive in another way. John Paul went to India. I remember the words he spoke when he was in Madras. I wasn't there at the time, I was there before and after it. When speaking to an interfaith group in Madras in 1986, he says, why is dialogue important? Because when we open ourselves to one another in dialogue, we open ourselves to God. And I think what he was saying is, you know, it's not that you find God in your religion and then on your day off, you go and have a dialogue with them, but that the interreligious encounter is a way of meeting God. And I think for him is, again, not the most liberal of popes to say that is quite profound. Pope Benedict was more concerned about relativism and the like and their issues there. Pope Francis is a interreligious pioneer in his own way. As we know, he's had very good relations with the Muslim world. He was recently in Iraq, sat down with the Grand Ayatollah, and they had a conversation about, you know, their shared concerns about what Islam and Christianity have in common regarding the plight of the people and so on. He wrote his beautiful encyclical recently, Fratelli Tutti, really about how to be a decent human being and a decent Christian in the 21st century. And it all focuses toward the final eighth chapter about interreligious brotherhood and sisterhood. And this is a changing church, and therefore, how do we take all of this into account? But at the same time, other religions are not waiting for us to do something. It used to be when I was first went to India that there was a sense that if I wanted to meet a Hindu, I had to go to India, or I had to go, you know, look at a map and find out where that temple in Queens was or something like that. But actually now religions are migrating, diaspora Hinduism, diaspora Buddhism, diaspora Islam, all the traditions are now around us. And the places in which we live, I'm sure it's true in Calgary as it is in Boston, are interreligious places. And this is changing it not only because now we live in interreligious places, but because religions adjust to new climates and cultures. And so we begin to think differently and act differently toward one another. Hindu-Christian encounter in Toronto or Calgary or Boston or New York isn't going to be exactly the same as it was in Chennai or Delhi or Varanasi or Kathmandu. These things are changing. And how do we take into account these changes? I think you need the energy of a young person to keep up with all the changes, but nonetheless, I try to pay attention. And then changes more fundamentally, and I learn this from my students all the time at BC First and certainly now at Harvard, how we think of what it means to be religious. We all know the phrases like spiritual but not religious, nuns, none of the above, students crafting their own spiritual path, choosing ways to be religious, mainstream denominations declining membership, half empty churches, even when there's no pandemic, churches half empty because older people are getting older and fewer, and young people are not going to church on Sunday, or temple on Sunday, or synagogue on Sunday, on the weekend. All these things are changing over time. People more concerned, not about reading the great text, but about living religion. So often my students say to me, we get along very well, but will say to me, you know, why are we reading all these texts? What about the living religion of people? How do people live their faith? They want to know, because they're looking about how to live their own faith. Ethnography, field work come to the fore. Practice, like what are you doing to help people as a criterion for religion rather than doctrine or basic scriptures and so on like that. All of this is changing. And I think to be aware of the fact that these changes are affecting how we think of our own identities, whether we're religious people or not, and whether what we think about interreligious learning or dialogue of some sort, it's differing and changing before our eyes, and what things will be like in 50 years, we don't really know. How we will be religious, or what it will mean to be a religious North American or a religious Indian. These things are really underway. And of course, the great fact of secularization, the fact that many people are opting not to be religious, not only to not join a church, but saying, well, that you can use terms like spirituality or not. And you can be a person who has a certain integrity and ethical, moral status, you know, commitment without being religious at all. And sometimes when you look, you realize, well, one great dialogue is between the Hindus and the Catholics and the Hindus and the Buddhists and the Buddhists and the Muslims and so on like that. And all people of faith with the large community of people who try to be good without relying on faith traditions. How do we handle that and figure that into what we do when people like me continue to teach Hinduism and Christianity and read the Bhagavad Gita and read Tamil poetry? The reasons why we do this somehow have to be changing, because we can't pretend we're living 50, 60, 100 years ago. All of these things are changing around us, which leaves, and then I would just add, we don't know the effect of this past year yet. The pandemic years, we're hopefully coming out of it. The vaccines are around. Maybe things are opening up again. But also the great tragedies of racial violence. The United States is suffering and sadly remembering the death anniversary yesterday of Breonna Taylor and the so many acts of violence against Black people, systemic racism, all kinds of problems around us. Weave that in with what will the world be like after the pandemic. There's this open future that we don't really know what things will be like in 2030. So those are issues before us. which leads me to the final part, and I'll just a few more minutes and then I will be done with my comments. Where do we go from here? I think the boastful title of my talk at the beginning was something about, you know, my future work in Hindu-Christian studies, which is somewhat boastful because at 70, you can't plan on a long future. Even if I had 20 years, it's not going to be forever. But nonetheless, having, unlike, sadly, again, Peter Craigie, who didn't have the chance to do his work in his 50s and 60s and 70s, how do you act and how do you do your work at different points in your life, whether you're very young today or very old today? How do we do this? Part of it is you do the things that are offered to you. And I think I find at this point in my life, I'm doing a whole range of things that I wouldn't have thought of doing previously because people ask me to do things. So I'm writing a response essay now to a volume on ecology and world religions. And sort of, I'm supposed to be the interfaith master who can take together the scientific papers, the Christian papers, the Hindu, Buddhist, Muslim papers, and say something meaningful about it. I know nothing much about science. I worry about the environment like you do, but nonetheless, that's coming around. I'm just finishing a long review essay on a book called Jesuit Kaddish. Father James Bernauer at BC has kind of capped his lifelong work on Jesuits and Jews, the happy, sad history of Jesuits and Jews, by writing this wonderful book. So I'm writing about that without being a scholar of Judaism. Improbably, I'm writing an essay on Georg Hegel and Hinduism, and realizing that for hundreds of years, people have been writing an awful lot about Hegel. But people ask me, well, what do you think about Hegel and Hinduism? And I'm trying to finish that essay. And I just wrote a long review essay on Isabel Wilkerson's book called Caste, the book on caste and racism and so on like that, and trying to make sense of it, respecting what she does, but also pointing out what she doesn't do. So I'm doing all these things that I just do them because people ask me to do them. And I think as you get older, you do that. I was reading recently Goethe, the great poet, dramatist, artist. And in the beginning of his autobiography, this will be the one quote, I'll read you this, and then I'll wrap up fairly quickly. He's writing about, why would I write an autobiography? And he's basically saying he's an older person, and people ask him different questions about why you put your life together the way you do. And this is just a little paragraph from his introduction to his autobiography. The author, even to the most advanced period of his life, should not relinquish the advantage of communicating, even at a distance, with those whom affection binds to him. If it is not granted to everyone to step forth anew at a certain age with surprising and powerful productions, yet just at that very period of life when knowledge is most full and perfect, consciousness is still distinct, it must be a very agreeable and reanimating task to look back over former creations and things you did when you were young and work them up into a kind of last act, which may serve as an edification for those who come after you. I sort of like that. Any of us who are older on the screen today might like that when you're near the end of your life than the beginning, you begin to think about, how can I wrap this up in a way of wisdom? And I think for me, and I'll just do this and then stop, is that it goes back to where I started about entering a religious order, being a Jesuit, being a priest, and studying Hinduism, teaching Hinduism as a priest at Harvard and all these things over the years, that there's a certain sense in which what I realize I'm trying to do is be a scholar practitioner and show a way of being a person who's a practitioner, a person of faith, a scholar in a world in which you're not simply there for your own people, but for all the interfaith people around you. So how do you be a scholar? How do you be a practitioner? How do you weave these together so that you're not a scholar on the weekdays and a practitioner on the weekend or something, but these things are connected. And then how do you do this when you're 20 or 40 or 60 or 70 in a vastly changing world? And while I think the terminology of priest, Catholic priest in general, or Hindu priest and so on, is somewhat specialized, there's a way in which there's kind of a learned priesthood, learned ministry that is deeply involved here. And I'll just give 4 points and then I will stop with this. The scholar practitioner is involved with the word. There is the word of God, if you have the Bible, the word of the Veda, the word of the Buddhist suttas, the Quran, and so on like that. But there's also the word of your academic work, the word of the classroom, and so on like that. How do you study, teach, write about the word in a way that brings it to life and affects people's lived religion? How do you do this in a convincing way where you're not simply writing fairly dull and dry books on the side and people are living wildly interesting religious traditions outside? How do you bring the word to life? And certainly in the Catholic Church, I'm used to the fact that you give a homily, you give a short sermon at Mass, but then it leads into the communion, it leads into the Eucharist. And the words are there only to lead into something deeper and more. How do you be right as a scholar, thinker, spiritual person in a way that connects to worship and connects to real life, connects to the table? Part of it for a pastor, a minister, anybody who's in a leadership position in communities is to convene community and bring it together. If you're a scholar and you're teaching, you're constantly trying to do this in the classroom. If you have a commitment in a religious place of worship, you're trying to do it there. How do you do it and say, well, look, I'm all of this. For me, it's the scholar of Hinduism who's a Catholic priest. How do you do all of this in a way that convenes into religious communities as well? And says it's no longer enough to simply have a community among your own people, but somehow your community has to have boundaries and you cross these boundaries. Materiality, so much today is said about material religion. The stuff of religion, bodily, the body of religion, having a body, being an embodied person. But this is very, very Catholic for thousands of years about sacramentality, sacraments, what appeals to the five senses, kind of tasting, smelling, hearing, seeing, touching religion. How do you take all of that and realize that there are sacramental acts in traditions like in the Catholic Church, bread and wine that become the body and blood of Christ? How do you then say that the bodily nature of the world around us and our mixed interreligious society is somehow sacramental, and not simply to say you find God in all things as Jesuits will do, but rather to say, well, all of this is sort of being made sacred by the efforts we make to make it sacred. It may be grace, but nonetheless, we have to do our part. And then finally, the last one would be, there's a great emphasis, I think, in many religious traditions, you have to be what you pretend to be. And so if you call yourself a priest, don't be a scoundrel. Don't be just a cleric who's just doing it for the ambition or the prestige. If you're going to be a Brahmin priest, if you're going to be a Catholic priest, if you're going to be imam, if you're going to be a rabbi, if you're going to be a leader in the Native American community, and so on and so on, they want to see that you are what you say. And how do you, the whole theme you can see for me is starting as a young person, how do you be interreligiously with a commitment in a tradition, but in a way that makes it authentic, that who you are as a person kind of overflows into the rest of the life around you. And showing particularly the younger people, you can keep the faith, you can keep your commitments, you can be interreligious, you can ask every question and then still have a coherent life. And I think as we get older, maybe the thing we can do is to encourage young people and saying, yes, you can do this. This is not impossible to be able to hold all these pieces together. So I stop there with some kind of a sense that where I'm going in my current moment, but in this changing world, is somehow to hold together all these pieces and be a certain kind of scholar practitioner, because that's something we very much need in the world today. But thank you very much for listening to my presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Clooney. That was absolutely lovely. And I already got several questions. And that was just lovely. And I'm going to use my speaker's prerogative. I want to ask the first question. But I'm actually quite interested in following up on some of what you've just been talking about. And something you mentioned right at the beginning, how do we work to help connect these old texts, as you say, with the living traditions to the students we're teaching? I often struggle with this when I'm teaching Syriac texts, which, in translation, which are so beautiful and so far in the past and trying to make students, you know, in the present realize how important this is to any living tradition, right? Whether you're a Syriac Christian or not. And so I'm interested in your thoughts on that. And then I'll start reading the questions.
Yeah. No, I think, I mean, that's a perfect example of our fields may be different, but we share the same challenges in the classroom, how to bring these things to life. I think, I mean, for me, it helps. My default starting point is, I couldn't, you know, and not everybody has this opportunity, but on the weekends I preach. And so I have to be able to stand up in front of a congregation and say that the text we just heard means something to you in 2021. Mm-hmm. And like yesterday, I preached on the reading of the day in the Christian calendar, the fourth Sunday of Lent, the second book of Chronicles of all texts, not a very famous part of the Bible, but nonetheless saying there's something here about this return when Cyrus says you can go home. There's an invitation for us to go home in 2021, return to our starting places. But how do you do that? The reason I say that is because that's not what we do in the classroom, but some default starting point is that the classic text of our traditions are never simply the past, but that we need to have some kind of confidence that if we, you know, give ourselves over to them, if we read them, if we enter upon them, if we study them, then they begin to have an effect on us or they change us. We can't read them as if we were living in the 3rd century, the 8th century, or the 19th or 20th century, but somehow the engagement with a text works. I mean, it sounds really mundane or kind of self-obvious. With my students who are mostly, you know, in their 20s, and it's very diverse at Harvard Divinity School. Occasionally I get students from the college coming over. But to get somebody who's, let's say, 25 reading a text like the Bhagavad Gita, or reading the devotional, great devotional text, the Bhagavata Purana about Krishna and the dance of Krishna, or read the Gospel according to Matthew, or read the Song of Songs, if they actually start reading it with a certain sense of permission that they don't have to have a PhD in this in order to read it, that it begins to click with their lives. And they may fight with it, saying, well, you know, who are the privileged people who wrote this text and whose voices were not heard in the Brahminical system or in the Catholic Church? But saying, well, yeah, that you can still get into it. So I think I tell them, you know, if it was just a matter of reading, we wouldn't have to have class at all. We could just all stay home and just read our books. But if you're going to meet in class, it's you know, me at my age and them at their age and people in between struggling with the text and sharing why we think, why you and me think it matters still. And then hopefully enthusing, you know, getting them enthused about this. But the basic conviction is these texts are never out of date. And if I say that about the Bible, I mean that about the Quran and the Rig Veda and the Buddhist Suttas and Native American traditions too, that they're never out of date because they're alive.
That's lovely. Thank you so much. All right, I'll start. I will not hog the question period. I will pass on to the first question. Did you encounter Bede Griffiths in your travels? He was very much involved in bringing Christian and Hindu traditions together, and he had an ashram in southern India in Shantivanam. What are your thoughts on his efforts to bridge the gap, if you're familiar with him?
Yeah, so Bede Griffiths, a fascinating British gentleman who was already famous before he went to India. He wrote a book called The Golden Thread about his conversion to Catholicism and becoming a monk. Then he goes to Kerala to an ashram, Kurasi Mulla Ashram in Kerala. Then he goes to the famous Shantivanam, the famous beautiful ashram in deep South India, taking over from 2 French priests who had been there before him, Henri Lissot and Jules Monchanan. Lissot, fairly famous as Swami Abhishektananda, whose bliss is the anointed or the Christ. So Bede Griffiths get there and the ashram is like on unsteady ground. It's like near collapse. Monchanan had died and Abhishektananda went off to the north, to the Himalayas. And it was like a gift of God to South India that Bede Griffiths was the most wonderful pastoral person. And I only met him once. I visited him in 83 there. And he was just the most gracious person on earth in terms of he had nothing else to do except to talk to me who had come unannounced to the ashram. Very, very gracious. But I think his instinct was a person who had gone through his own spiritual journey and his own conversion was that the possibility of building community inclusive community graciously of bringing together people of different traditions, finding ways to de-Westernize the Catholic Church in South India with their little village temple style church, the welcoming of everybody into their strictly vegetarian ashram meals and so on like that. And then writing his own beautiful meditations, like his book called River of Compassion, his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, or his, I think it's called The Marriage of East and West, book later in his career. So I think he was like, he was not the greatest scholar of the Catholics in India. And he admitted that, I think. But he was one of the most brilliant pastoral people who knew very much, because he had lived there so long, about if you're a decent human being with a certain sense of graciousness, you can convene a community across religious boundaries. And I think he really is still remembered and admired for that, some 30 years after his death. And we can try to be like that, because he was a wonderful man.
Thank you. So the next question, let's see. As churches, religions change, would you say that being a missionary is or always has been a way to change the other to be more like the people who are coming in? Can you comment on that?
I think in theory, I mean, this is a great question that we could go on for an hour about, I suppose. But at one level, that's what it seemed like, because when you get, the great missionary command at the end of Matthew's gospel, go and preach the gospel to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it does seem you're bringing Christ, you're bringing salvation, and they changed. Now, as I said earlier, the Jesuits worried about what does the change mean? Does it mean dressing differently, eating differently, changing your name, or just changing like the ultimate essence of who you are by switching to faith in Christ? It comes across as we're going there to change them. And often they thought, or usually they thought, save them. But I think we know in the North American context too, it can be disastrous if you think, well, here I am, I get off the ship or get off the boat or get off the railway station. I have come to change you and make you a decent person. Is disastrous. It's also arrogant, and it's also not very spiritual, I don't think. So I think without demeaning the history of missionaries who all parts of the world were really, I think often, usually, who am I to say, very, very good people, very generous with their life and their death, that it really worked best when they were changed in the context when they got there. And I remember meeting some old missionaries in Bihar back in the 70s around Patna, out in the mission stations and all that, who'd been like living out in the jungle for 40 years. And they had seemed to be, the sort of Christian Hindus at that point, and they had changed a lot over time. And I think the ones that were most successful were the ones who didn't come in saying, I am here to change you, but that I'm trying to build community. I'm trying to be with you, teach you, run the medical station, study together and so on like that. And it becomes kind of a conversation or a dialogue at a deeper level, like Bede Griffiths said, Shantivanam. There's still the element, and one sees, across the Christian churches, a great diversity from very, you might say, very evangelical. We're still going to India in 2021, and we're still trying to convert those people. To living together in harmony is the goal. And I think there's a range in there. I would just say that for me, we could talk further about this, other questions, but for me, I think as I've told people over the years, I went to Kathmandu probably not knowing really what I was doing at age 22, but I pretty much figured out in my first weeks there, this was more about me changing than them changing. And I think I thought at some decent level, here I am a guest in this culture and these people are really nice to me. Even high school kids were nice to me, as high school kids can be, when they're not being cruel to you. They were really nice to me. And I think it was like gratitude for they're not like throwing stones at me or kicking me out, and that I was to change. And one reason I didn't spend the rest of my life in Kathmandu, and I could still be there, if I lived, was rather because I thought, well, we in the United States are the ones who need to change now. And that learning and being in another culture, seeing how people live their religious lives, we have so many stereotypes and blind spots about them. that we back in the United States, and this is 1970s United States, we have no idea how other people live and who they are. Now we have a bit more because, again, diaspora, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and so on, our neighbors are often of other faiths. But I felt that my job was to come back and change how we think about ourselves, how not how we, you know, water down or dissipate Catholic faith, but how we open it up in the way I think that John Paul was saying in his own way, and certainly Francis is saying in his way as popes. The theological problem underlying all of that is, do you think they are saved or not? And that often is a, you know, it's a tough question. Are they saved only in Christ? The Catholic answer since Vatican II has been basically God's salvation is for all. All are given the pathway to salvation through Christ. And the church is open to all that is good and beautiful and true in their faith traditions. And all those things don't seem logically to hold together. But I think that's the Catholic way of doing things, is say things that are really important and just hope that they hold together, even though you can't explain. If you try to explain them, you get into terrible trouble. But this idea that we bring Christ, there's nothing more valuable than knowing Christ. And we have everything in the world to learn about from Krishna, from Rama, from the Buddha, from the Prophet Muhammad, and so on and so on. And that kind of dynamic of you can't witness to your faith unless you allow people you meet to witness to their faith in your life.
It's great. It's a lovely, definition of it. Next question. How has your understanding of Catholicism changed as a result of your study of Hinduism in such depth?
I mean, this is not the first time I've been asked that question. I can answer it in two ways, both of which may seem flip at to start with. One is it hasn't changed at all. I've been a Jesuit for 53 years and a priest for 43 years, and I haven't been kicked out of the order yet or, you know, defrocked or anything like that. I'm still a Catholic priest, and it's not really up to me to change the Catholic religion. It's the church, it's the creed, we have endless bishops and hierarchies and so on who do the teaching stuff. So on one level, with my parish connection, I mentioned the same parish for over 23, going on 24 years now, functioning as a Catholic priest as I might, who knows, if I had never gone to India or never learned from Hinduism. On the other hand, and this may also seem flip, I think everything has changed all the way through. And by this, I mean that when I went to Kathmandu, not knowing what I was getting into, and suddenly being touched first by visiting temples and the stupas and Dakshinkali temple and reading the poetry of Tagore and so on, it started this enormous deep, I'd like to think deep, certainly sustained process of the deep things of my own faith and the deep things of the Hindu faith resonating with one another. And it wasn't so much that now I have 10 new things from Hinduism that I will transplant onto the side of my Catholic faith and I'll have these extra things there. I mean, I have learned enormously about liturgy, about worship, about images of deities, about how to live a human life by reading Hindu texts and so on. I could, you know, give you a list of 100 things, but I think a lot of it was that because I was changing, and the whole point of what I've been saying is that somehow at the same time, being Catholic and giving my life to learning, trying to learn deeply from Hindu traditions, everything has sort of a different affect to it or a different color to it or a different flavor to it. So when I preach on Sundays, I rarely mention anything Hindu. Catholics are supposed to preach, 7-8 minutes, not give long talks. But I almost never mention things Hindu, but I think just about every homily I give, I'm thinking something Hindu when I prepare it. There are echoes with Hindu texts, Hindu exegesis, Hindu ways of thinking. When I'm at the altar as a priest, I'm not really thinking right at the altar about it, but I realize when I'm at the altar as a priest, I'm not letting go of the fact that I've been in so many sacred temples and seeing people at worship in Hindu holy places. And these things kind of resonate with one another. I've tried at times to explain this, maybe most clearly in the book that was the book that I had that was most controversial with conservative Hindus and conservative Catholics. So it was probably a good book. Divine Mother, Blessed Mother, Hindu Goddesses and the Virgin Mary. And what I tried to say is that we talk about, we have genuine concern about women in the church, the feminine side of religion, rethinking our model of God, not just as father and so on. And for some reason, American people, feminists and non-feminists alike, tend to ignore the 3,000 plus year of goddess worship in India, with a pile of classic texts and so on like that, and abundant evidence, and saying, why don't we learn from them and see how they do it? And there are all kinds of biases about why Americans might not want to learn from Indians, but nonetheless, I said it makes sense. So I wrote a book on three great goddess texts that draw you in and change you. Powerful, the goddess Lakshmi, Sri Lakshmi, the great Mahadevi, and then a Tamil goddess, Abhirami, writing about these poetry. And then on the other side of it saying, okay, now does this mean therefore that Catholic can now worship Hindu goddesses, Sri and Devi and Abhirami? Well, no, that's not gonna work. You can't add goddess worship into Catholicism. But doesn't it make you think about what have we done with the feminine, with the divine feminine? And while the Virgin Mary is not a goddess, in some churches you might think that she is, the enormous piety of Mary and the importance of Mary, somehow to retrieve and rethink the role of Mary in the Catholic Church, because of my study of Hindu goddesses, I think changed everything for me related to the Virgin Mary, even though I'm not saying Mary is a goddess, but it changed my attitude. So as the 1970s, you know, after Vatican II, in many circles, the piety of Mary went downhill. All those pieties of the 40s and 50s kind of disappeared for a while, at least, except among very conservative Catholics. But for me, the path was, if I can learn from Hindu goddesses and be open to the divine feminine in India, how can I possibly consistently say, well, piety of Mary is not biblical and it's a really bad idea? No, I think it opened me to Mary again. So that kind of thing, of those odd ways, I realize I'm not giving a very clear answer, but everything has changed, even though nothing has changed in terms of how I'm Catholic still because of my learning from Hinduism.
That's great, thank you. The next question comes from Dr. Rupero. Could you please say more about how you see colonialism and the post-colonial context entering into the practice of interreligious study? Given the still unequal social, political, linguistic, economic context between India and the West, in quotations, do Western scholars have a special responsibility to India? And if so, what that might that be?
First, I'd like to say hello to Professor Ruparel. I believe regarding giving this lecture, he was my first contact a few years back before everything was slowed down by pandemic. But hello, Tinner, nice to see you. Let me say something, and you may want to come back on this because you know more about this than I do, I think, is that we're living in this skewed situation in which the hundreds of years of the Western domination of the rest of the world, colonialism, Orientalism, capitalism, and so on, have instilled great deep abuses of other people's lives and cultures, and this happens in North America as well, obviously, of other people's lives and cultures. And all of that doesn't go away quickly. It's like saying, well, racism goes away quickly or anti-Semitism goes away quickly because we think they're awful. No, they're still there. They're still systemic. And I think it's also the case that the way we study religions is also either enabled by, but also infected by colonialism, Orientalism, imperialism, and so on. And for so long, it was taken for granted when I was in grad school, we study India and we study Hinduism, and all of us are white Americans. Now there were several faculty at Chicago who were not white Americans when I was there, but it's basically, we in the West are doing the proper study of India and Hinduism that the Hindus don't do, because they don't have the right methods, they don't have the right sense of history, and so on and so on. And I think in some ways it was well meant, and you can trace this back to the 19th century and even the 18th century of Western Indology, dictionaries, grammars, and study and so on like that. But I think by now, there's been a great sense that this was insufferable, and that many a Hindu voice, some to the extreme right, I think, but many sensible voices that just are saying, this is so skewed. You people in America think you know more about our culture and our country than we do. So there's that whole layer of issues about who knows best and the expert outsider flying in and giving a lecture and then flying out and sort of knowing so much about everything. It sounds more and more foolish as time goes on. The other is, and I'm not sure, Tina, if this was part of your original question, but aware of the fact that, you know, people have said to me, well, you're so elitist as a scholar. You spend your time reading Sanskrit texts, and even the Tamil texts you read are not the ordinary texts of the people. There are these classic, hard to read texts and all that. The subaltern voices and the Dalit peoples and the people who are excluded, all of that you read as if none of those giant issues of oppression and exclusion are there. And that's a tough one because everything I think we do, you know, we live in privileged academic worlds, many of us, and what's more privileged than Harvard University, where I am. We're living, you know, off the lifeblood of other peoples, and we have lots of money because other people don't have lots of money. And we can have the leisure of choosing what we study and what we do, and we still make our salaries and so on like that. How do you kind of, you know, with some authenticity, break through that and learn from the other without saying, let's pile up all the Sanskrit texts and burn them all because they're all elitist? How not to do that, but still learn? I wrote a review, it's not in print yet, I can't share it with you, but of Isabel Wilkerson's book, Caste. And it's very profound. It's by no means, you know, books have been written on this topic through the last 70 or 80 years. On caste and racism, casteism and racism. And on one level, it's a brutal reminder to people like me. You go to India, you study Hinduism, and how often do you visit the great slums outside Mumbai? Or how often do you talk to the people who are, you know, genuinely afraid for their lives because of the system and so on like that? But on the other level, in a sense, I think a book like that book, which is a best-selling book, Caste, is also a symptom of the imperialism, because Hinduism and caste are being used as props in a story about American problems. And while she has every good intention in the world and has a prophetic voice, it's still saying, well, we know about all the awful things that happen in India, and they shed light on the awful things happening here. Let's talk about here, having talked about India briefly. And I think there's something wrong even with that, because it is incredibly well-meant, but it also, it's infected. Now, some people say, finally, go all the way down, that if you have an evangelical attitude, if you really believe Christ is the savior of the world, you're going to end up, you know, caught up in some kind of demeaning relationship to the other. The only solution is to be a relativist and say all things are equal or none of them are true anyway, so let's just live together. And I think that's a dead end. That's some kind of a sense of faith and commitment, deep commitment to what you believe, should turn into respect and repentance in relationship to the other. And if you give up and have no beliefs and no faith and no values, that is definitely not a step forward. So I'm rambling, but those are some thoughts I have on this very difficult topic.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you, Tina.
All right, we have about a little over 10 minutes left, and I've got three questions. So let me just find, okay. It sounds like being successful as a missionary means visiting and coming to realizing the other is good. What are some of the great points of commonality between Hinduism and Catholicism?
I think, I think they're overwhelmingly present. Again, one can start by saying, well, these religions are really different. And if somebody, the more somebody knows nothing about Hinduism, the more easily they can say Catholicism and Hinduism have nothing in common. Just as I've known some people in India who think the worst of Christianity and say, well, that's nothing like our religion. Mm-hmm. So ignorance is a great way of keeping the traditions separate from one another. But I would say for Hinduism, and I sort of implied this throughout, Hinduism and Catholicism are sacramental traditions. ritual appeal to all five senses, the spiritual senses, is basic. Worship is important. Even though Catholicism doesn't have goddesses, the role of the Virgin Mary, I think, is a saving grace in honoring the male and the female both at the core of the religion. Community matters. And I say that even though, Catholic Church has often been infected with racism and so on, and Hinduism, there are problems of untouchability and caste and so on, building community. And even though people say, well, you know, Catholicism is by no means a tolerant religion because you just do what the Pope tells you, whereas in Hinduism, we have a million different ways of being. Everybody who actually is Catholic knows that the Pope says one thing and then Catholics do 1,000 different things. It's like herding cats, as they say. And there's a function to having a central authority, but there's so many different ways of being Catholic. It's like a big tent religion. And some people don't like to hear this because they say, no, we should have a small true church and get rid of everybody else. But there's a way in which there's this inclusivism that I think is both Hindu and Catholic. The heavens are crowded. In Hinduism, it's talked about as many, many, many deities, many gods and goddesses, in the old story of beings going up and down between heaven and earth. The Catholic saints, angels, in some circles that's kind of fallen out, but the populated universe in which we live. And then I guess finally, I just say that texts like the Bhagavad Gita, or like the Upanishads, or like the Ramayana of Tulsidas or Valmiki, anybody who reads these texts along with the Bible finds, oh, there are lots of connections here, resonances back and forth. So I find right from the beginning, I'm a Catholic and I find Hinduism really easy to understand. How one would talk about this as a Baptist or a Lutheran or other Christian traditions might be different, and I wouldn't exclude that. But I think Hinduism and Catholicism are meant for each other, kindred spirits.
Thank you. Very practical question. Would you be disciplined as a priest if you mentioned Hindu things or references in your sermons?
I don't think so. It would depend on how I did it. If I got up and said, okay, we're going to skip the communion today. We're going to have this goddess statue. We'll come up and worship the goddess. That I might get in trouble for. If I consistently said, well, there's really no difference among these religions. They're all sort of the same. If I said that, but if I said, I was in India and I went to a temple and this reminded me of what we do on Good Friday, I think that would be fine. Or if I said, Jesus is talking here about do not care about what you shall eat or drink. And Krishna in the Gita says, be detached, care not about success or failure. One helps to illuminate the other. That'd be fine. If I bring in Gandhi and use Gandhi in a homily, which I've done occasionally, not a problem. So it depends on where you are. In some circles, I once was visited a diocese for I was doing some teaching. And I think it was such a conservative diocese that I'd get invited to a number of parishes once and then not get invited back. But I think in big dioceses like Boston, New York, and so on, there's a variety of parishes. In some parishes, it's fine. In other parishes, maybe less welcome. As long as you don't like cross obvious boundaries and say things that are really, say at the door of the church, but don't say it at the altar because it's not appropriate.
Great. All right. I have a two-parter here from our new Fulbright scholar, Dr. Rob. She says, first, a quick comment. What you said at the beginning of the talk about the balance between fostering a connection with a particular subject while not eliding real differences in the process really resonated with me, who was raised outside of the religious tradition that I study, Islam and South Asia specifically. I was grateful and inspired to hear you reflect on the attempt to strike this balance. And then her question, I'm also very interested in material religion, but I'm interested specifically in material text, how the word is written word is in itself material, has an embodied quality, takes shape with reference to the body and through the work of bodies. So as I'm sure you know, thinking about gender within religious context is not just about the feminine, but also increasingly there is a desire to engage with queer theory as well. Thinking about gender categories between cisgender categories. One thing that I find compelling about Hinduism is the ways that gender bending, Ardhana Shivera, the divine composition of Shiva and Parvati comes to mind, and the ways that Vishnu Lakshmi are worshipped together. The existence and recognition of a third gender, often referred to as hijras in South Asia. What do you think about the queerness of Hindu tradition, and do you think there are resonances in Catholicism?
Well, thank you, Dr. Rob, for such wonderful questions. I mean, on the first part, I would say easily, I think things go much better and are far more interesting if we don't erase the differences among the things we study. And it's not the sense of we have differences and therefore we have oppositions and therefore we have to choose sides, but that allowing the rough edges and the differences to just be part of who you are, the uneven terrain, is really helpful learning-wise, imaginatively, and also spiritually. Some sense that at the end of the day, as well as the beginning, you're crossing over and coming back is really important. I'm not sure I totally understood what the question was with the second part, but certainly it's true, as you said, that helping us to reimagine issues of gender identity. I mean, Vishnu and Lakshmi, as you say, are Dhanishwara, Shiva, Parvati is one being, male and female together. And the tolerance of what we might say trans people in Hindu communities in many places, I think is part of a deep sense of the plurality intrinsic to reality, that things are always going to be differentiated, and that the divine as well as the human and the path to the divine is never going to be so simple that other things can be excluded. And I think it has always been provocative in terms of opening things up. The Catholic Church has its own problems with power in the church and exclusion of women from power and issues about sexual identity and so on. And it's not that all Hindus are flaming liberals or all Hindus, say everything is okay for my family, but there is a sense of the ability to imagine the possibilities more fluidly as bodily and spiritual realities both. I'm not sure I'm getting the heart of what you are asking, but if you wanted to push it a step further, you could.
All right, I have two questions left and 3 minutes. So I might, I suspect you and Dr. Rob can carry on that conversation.
Okay, tomorrow. All right. We'll email or something. Okay.
All right. There's so many questions here coming up. Dr. Palacios has said, how does the scholar serve the faith in the world in your experience and from your perspective? And I think we'll use that as our last question to wind this up. It's a lovely way to end the conversation.
Now, is Dr. Palacios the one in the front of the screen or in the back of the screen?
Yeah.
thank you for that question. Could you repeat the question? Now I got distracted.
Yes, no, absolutely. She says she would like to hear you speak more about how does the scholar serve the faith and the world in your experience and from your perspective?
I think, I mean, anybody who's a good scholar has to realize there is definite limitation to what I can do. And any kind of sense that, I am the world savior and I have come and I can handle all problems is not going to work. So we all have like the thing we can do. And I think different scholars have different ways of serving. And I think some become, great public intellectuals, some become prophetic figures, some write, vastly well-read books and so on. But I think for many of us, it's a matter of insisting on certain things that we have found to be true throughout our careers. And for me, in both Catholic context and interreligious context and secular context, about the value of learning from other religious traditions and the refusal to reduce everything to secularity and the refusal to privatize religion as a personal thing, keep it to yourself, and that any conversation in the public forum has to be an interreligious one, keep making those points over and over again, and not allowing us to use other people's traditions as talking points and arguments with ourselves. All of those things, I think, are kind of, trying to, preserve civilization. by saying we can have a decent conversation where there's ambiguity and plurality, even though I may have strong feelings and you have other strong feelings, we try to keep these things flowing. It would be fine-tuned according to expertise of different people on the screen here, how we do it. But back to the insistence that the arcane work we do that three people in the world read has an overflow in our teaching and then in the life around us. For me, in my example is, yes, you can be a believing Christian. You can be a Catholic priest and interreligiously open. You can really have deep affection for and learning from Hinduism and still be a Catholic priest. There's nothing impossible about this. And you can be an imam and do this, and a Buddhist monk can do this, and a Brahmin and do this. All of these boundaries are stereotyped as rigid and exclusive, and they're not. And I think we just have to show that in the civilized society, intelligent interfaith commitment is really, really important, and we need it, and we can do it, so we should do it. Now there are three professors on the screen there. I see all of you.
Thank you so very much. We'll leave it today. And I just, on behalf of everybody in the talk and the department, I just want to thank you for a really lovely talk that's given us all a lot to think about. And to reiterate that we can carry on this conversation tomorrow afternoon at 3:00 through the department. Thank you so much, Dr.
Thank Clooney. You so much. Wonderful questions. Thank you all for coming and staying for the whole time. Thank you. I appreciate this. See you tomorrow, I hope.
Thank you. I also would just like to, first off, I would like to thank Professor Clooney for this such an interesting and insightful talk. On behalf of the library and on my personal behalf, I truly enjoyed it. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Cassis. And I just want to say that this is such a wonderful partnership that we have with the Department of Classics and Religion, and it's so wonderful to see. I feel honored being involved with all this, and it's so wonderful to see previous and future presenters here, Dr. Rob, Dr. Music, Dr. Ferzocco, and Dr. Ruparel. And speaking of Dr. Ruparel, our next program in a partnership with the Classics and Religion Department is on Wednesday, March 17th at 7 p.m. It is part of the Exploring Religion series, and it's the Dance of Atheism. So please join us then, and also please visit our website and check out other very interesting programs that we are offering. There are more Exploring Religion programs that will be happening in March and one in April. Thank you again. Thank you all for spending part of your Sunday with us. This was really and truly wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.